you know, to your left-hand side, you're going to see a beautiful garden, and in the background, the other side of the Mirabel Palace. And these are the Mirabel Gardens. They're designed in Baroque style, and they're designed by a man called Johann Bertram Fischer von Erler. He was a Salzburg architect, and you're going to see a lot of his work today, so remember that name. Looking to your left, you'll also see some old walls. These aren't just any old walls. These are the old city walls. They used to go around Prince Archbishop. He was called Paris Lautron, and it was Paris Lautron who also founded Salzburg. So we're just turning into one of Salzburg's many squares. This is called Makert Square. It's named after the famous Salzburg painter Hans Makert. Now if you look to your right, you will see an apricot coloured house. And this apricot coloured house, very important, this is Mozart's residence, where he lived between 1773 and 1780. He lived with his family and they owned 8 rooms on the first floor. And these 8 rooms, they've now been turned into the right-hand side now. This is the Church of the Holy Trinity, designed by Johann Bertram Fischer von Erlach. This is the sister church of the Karls Church in Vienna. We're going to be seeing the 2 larger churches in just a few minutes there in the Old Town. And looking straight ahead of the bus, you're getting your first glimpse of the Old Town of Salzburg over on the other side of the river. In the background, you'll also see a big rock. This is the first of our city mountains. We've got 2 city mountains. This one's called the Mönchsberg. In English, translates as the Monk's Mountain of the Sacher Torte, and the Austrians call it their most famous chocolate cake in the world. It's absolutely delicious, rich chocolate cake with a layer of apricot jam. And because it was used during the salt trade to transport the salt from the mountains south of Salzburg into the city. And the salt is where Salzburg gets most of its wealth from. Now look to your left-hand side. In a couple of moments, you're going to see an arch. Look under the arch, and if it's not blocked by a bus, you're going to see a white, a little yellow house. Unfortunately, I can't stay here for very long, but you'd have caught a glimpse of a little yellow house, and this was where Mozart was born. He was born in this house on the third floor on the 27th of January 1756. And he lived in this house until 1773, when he moved over the river to the house which we've just seen. And then, 1780, he moved to Vienna. Now, I mentioned Mozart is Salzburg's most famous son, but Mozart, and it was in Vienna where he died in 1791 at the age of 35.
What, 35?
Yes.
Young.
Very, very young. And the thing is, we'll never know what he died from, because at the end of his life he was incredibly poor. He had no money, so he couldn't afford a proper grave. He was buried in a communal grave, and we've never found his remains.
Oh.
The theory is, however, that he died from an overdose of mercury. So we know he suffered from syphilis, and at that time, mercury was used to cure syphilis. We're now in a particularly old part of Salzburg. If you look at all these houses around you, look right up to the top and you'll see the dates when they were built. So for example, the blue and orange houses in front of us, they were built in 1408. You can also see the dates when they were built. These houses are actually built into the mountain. This was a space-saving measure so that the Salzburgers could build more houses. They tend to go down to about minus 30. We're just driving through one of the old gates of Salzburg. This used to be part of the city walls, and this is where the horses and carriages used to drive through. Now if you look to your left-hand side, you're going to see a street, and this is the Getreidegasse, the main street in Salzburg. And if you look at all the beautiful wrought iron signs over each of the shops, even McDonald's has one. These signs have a very long history, dates back to the Middle Ages, and it was because at that time not that many people could read, So, they had to make a sign with a picture showing what each shop sold. If you look to your right hand side, you're going to see a fountain with a statue of a horse standing in the middle of it. It's not actually a fountain. This is where the horses used to get washed. And the statue in the middle of the fountain is not particularly important. It was just like the wrought iron signs in the Getreidegasse. It was a sign to show this is where you wash the horses. It was built in 1695 by Fischer von Erlach. And it's quite clever. It was really a car wash for horses. It's shallow at both ends and deep in the middle. The horses started off at one end and they'd walk through, dirty on one side, come out lovely and clean on the other. The horses used to be the stables. It was also built by Fischer von Erlach. And there's enough space in these stables for around 200 horses. At its peak, there are around 156 horses stabled in here. And this is during the 18th century. At that time, horses were so valuable that they actually had the same value as a house in the old town. But there are three performance spaces with enough space for 5,500 spectators. And when do we get all these spectators? Well, in the summer, this is when the Salzburger Festival takes place. And the festival, it was originally founded in 1920 by the writers Max Reinhardt and Hugo von Hofmannsthal. It's taken place every year since, and AD was founded by our patron saint. He was called St. Rupert. He founded here a monastery. It's called St. Peter's Monastery. And it's one of the oldest monasteries in the world. And it's the oldest monastery in Europe. The Great is better known as King Arthur. So this monastery is actually part of the King Arthur Trail. Then if you look a little bit further around to the left of the St. Peter Monastery, you see another tower. Unfortunately, I can't drive any closer because it's in a pedestrian zone. But you'll see some arches. If you walk through these arches, you will end up in the cathedral square directly in front of the cathedral. And the cathedral, it was founded. It leads to a suburb of Salzburg, so these buildings aren't particularly old. They're only around 75 years old. But in this area, we found traces of a settlement which is more than 3,000 years old. It was from a people called Illyria. They were an Indo-Germanic people, came to Salzburg 1000 BC. They founded a settlement, but unfortunately they were wiped out by an ice age. But when the ice then for around 300 years, not a lot went on, to be honest. Lots of nomads came and founded temporary settlements here, but apart from that, not a lot of action. But then in 696 AD, St. Rupert came along and he founded modern-day Salzburg. And I mentioned about the Celts starting warmed up, the water evaporated and it left behind crystalline soil deep into the mountains. Stayed a secret for many thousands of years. Then the Celts founded and started the salt trade. It was hard work though, to be honest. To start off with, they had to build a tunnel into the mountain and then break each piece of its peak in the 14th century. This is when the Habsburgers took over the throne in Austria. And if you have a job, and at that time all jobs were linked to the salt trade, and whilst you were employed, you couldn't leave the area. Now there was no unemployment and the economy just grew. The economy reached a second peak in the 16th century. This is when we discovered that salt is a... And then for 100 years, the palace was sold. It came into private hands. Two of the most famous owners were the Mad King Ludwig II of Bavaria. He was famous for his speaking to the house in Neuschwanstein. And he was one of the summer residences. The second famous owner was Max Reinhardt. And he built the palace in 1918. He lived here for 20 years. So in 1938, this is when the Germans came and made Austria part of Germany. And that meant that Max Reinhardt was a Jew. He had
Oh, one long train.
Would you like to take a picture of me? Thank you.
The ducks with the baby.
Oh my God, how gorgeous.
A lot of Salzburg's old town was destroyed. It was bombed right at the end of the war. Many of the beautiful buildings were destroyed. They have, however, been restored ever since. And you can hardly see any traces of the bombing. And going back to the fortress,